This is the debate right here. LL is a cultural icon. You don't come out your face and no, you don't borrow nothing. You don't say, you lucky to be on the racket.
What up, guys? Your boy Quake, and I'm back with a brand new episode of Who Really Won. And this time, we're going to go into the old school more, into the late 90s specifically, because this Cam and Mace beef got me hyped up about the 90s. And this one really isn't a beef. It's more of a battle that started over an ego, over some petty shit between a legend hip-hop MC and a newcomer. And this battle, when it first happened, garnered a lot of attention. I mean, this was between a legend MC and a newcomer, and this newcomer had a lot of buzz surrounding him because of the way he could spit. He was very talented. And of course, when you have a legend going against a newcomer, there's always an insane amount of interest. And as you can tell by the video title, I'm talking about LL Cool J versus Cannabis. Who really won? And this is one of those classic battles. I mean, it goes down in history as one of the best hip-hop beefs because it birthed some legendary diss tracks, it cemented LL Cool J's legacy, and it introduced Cannabis in a whole different level. And at that time, LL Cool J was looked at this top-tier MC, this legend, this guy who is still making hit records, who's been involved in various beefs. But this one was special because this one was against an MC who was fairly new and someone who could really, really, really spit bars. I mean, Cannabis was one of a kind. So you guys know the drill. We're first going to start it out with how the beef started. Then we're going to get into the major points in the beef. And then we're going to talk about who won the battle portion of the beef, which is the short-term portion of the beef. In the midst of the battle, who won it. And then we're going to talk about who won the war portion of the beef, which is longevity, who after the beef prevailed more. So with that being said, get your drink, get your popcorn, sit back, relax, and let's get into it. So the beef started in August of 1997 because in this time, LL Cool J was recording and preparing to release his album Phenomenon. And in August of 1997, he was preparing a track called 4321. And on this track, he was looking to put on new artists and some veteran artists. The veteran artists were, of course, Method Man and Redman. They were scheduled to appear on the track. And then the new artist that LL Cool J wanted to get was DMX and Cannabis. So in August of 1997, he called up Cannabis and DMX, told them he wanted them on the track, and they, of course, both came at the same time in the studio. Now, the story that LL Cool J tells and the story that Cannabis tells is almost essentially the same thing. There's just a little detail that's different. So when Cannabis and DMX showed up at the studio, Cannabis met LL Cool J. They were kicking it, talking about various things, and then Cannabis asked about LL Cool J's tattoos and asked if he could see them. So LL Cool J showed him most of his tattoos, but the one that caught the most attention from Cannabis was the mic on LL Cool J's arm. And this is where the story gets a little different from both ends. LL Cool J says that Cannabis really liked the tattoo and said that he wants to get one just like it. And then LL was like, that's kind of weird, bro. Like, get your own tattoo, get your own style, you know, get your own lane.
So, he walked up and he was like, yo, L, you know, yo, your tattoo, man, I like your tattoo, I'm gonna get one like that. I said, nah, homie, you know, you gotta get your own, you know. I didn't understand that, like, mentally. Like, I just didn't understand that. Nah, man, you gotta get your own joint. Like, I just didn't understand it. Like, it was no disrespect. I was like, nah, you got your own. Like, nah, I'll get one like that.
Cannabis, however, maintains that he did not say that he wants the exact same tattoo as LL Cool J and that he was just admiring the tattoo and that's it. So that night in the studio, DMX laid his verse, Cannabis laid his verse, and everything was fine that night. They left, and then a few days later passed, LL Cool J ended up calling Cannabis and said that, hey, I feel like you're playing me. I feel like this is a disrespectful verse. Can you come in again in the studio and change your verse? And of course, Cannabis looked up to LL Cool J. He still looks up to him to this day, so he had no problem changing the verse. So he came back and changed the first few lines in the song. And the lines that offended LL Cool J were just simply bars talking about he wanted to borrow the mic off of LL Cool J's arm, and LL Cool J didn't like that. He felt that that was disrespectful.
Method, where the guards at? Redman, where the squad at? L, is that a mic on your arm? Let me borrow that. Who's the god of rap, you saying it's nice. I be the nigga to death and be the dead nigga to life.
I'm the illest nigga alive, watch me prove it. I snatch your crown with your head still attached to it. Cannabis is the type to fight for mics. Beating niggas to death and beating dead niggas to life.
So after Cannabis changed his bars, he asked LL Cool J, could you change your bars because it sounds like you're going at me on this track? And LL Cool J promised that he would change his bars as well. Some months passed, and on October 14th, 1997, LL Cool J dropped his seventh studio album, Phenomenon. And on track 7, the track 4321, it featured DMX, Method Man, Redman, and Cannabis. But one thing that was off was that LL Cool J never changed his verse, dissing Cannabis.
My young sons fantasize of borrowing flows. Tell little shorty with the big mouth, the bank is closed. The symbol on my arm is off limits to challenges. You holding rusty swords, I swing the Excalibur. How dare you step up in my dimension? Your little ass should be somewhere crying on detention. Watch your mouth, better yet, hold your tongue. Now let's get back to this mic on my arm. If it ever left my side, it transformed into a time bomb. You don't want to bar that, you want to idolize. And you don't want to make me mad, nigga, you want to socialize.
And to add more fuel to the fire, LL Cool J never invited Cannabis to shoot the official video for 4321. If you look at the original video, it's only LL, Method Man, Redman, and DMX. There's no Cannabis in sight anywhere. Mind you, at the time, the public had no idea that Cannabis' verse was redone to remove that mic borrowing line. At the time, nobody knew LL Cool J was going at Cannabis, but the song was floating around in New York. A lot of people were hearing it, like radio DJs, studio engineers, and stuff like that. So people were calling Cannabis a punk for not responding. Cannabis kept hearing that, people kept getting in his ear, and he wanted to respond badly. So instead of responding, he decided to call LL Cool J to hopefully hash out any issues and work on a track together, because the industry was hearing that LL Cool J and Cannabis had beef and they wanted to end that noise completely. In that phone call, Cannabis basically tells LL that he feels really disrespected. People are calling him out, saying that he's a punk for not responding. And LL basically just said, listen, don't respond, don't diss me. Let's do a track together, because nobody knows that my verse is going at you. Like I said earlier, the general public had not heard the original version of the song. So LL was just like, stop, don't do anything. You know, you don't want to go down this path with me. You know, it's not going to go good. So Cannabis was cool with that. LL said, give me about a few months and then we'll work on a track together to end all this noise.
This particular situation is just so ill because I laid that verse already. Niggas got copies of the original record and they running around playing it, you know what I'm saying? And it just looks so fucked up, man. And like in my position, like where I'm at right now, I don't have anything, man. All I got is a reputation on the street. That's all I got, man. I don't have a family. I don't have, that's all I have. That's what I'm saying. That's all I have. And it, right now,
I'm feeling what you're saying. What can I do to make you feel more comfortable? What can we do to like make you feel better about the situation?
I just need people to know that you didn't mean it like that, man. That you wasn't coming at me. What's the biggest way to do that, man? Like you everywhere, man. You're everywhere. What's the biggest way to?
I don't know, because see, what you don't realize is that sometimes you can open up a can of worms thinking you're closing a can of worms. The majority of the world does not know about this situation.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Niggas is not running around the country knowing about this situation. You got 50 niggas in New York that are in the industry running around running their fucking mouths. I'm not interested in disrespecting you. All I want to do is treat you like a human being and like a man. You know what I'm saying? But I expect to get treated as such. When I heard the record, that's what I felt. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
After we talked about it, I understood. So I said, yo, change the joint. I didn't try to play you.
Right.
Put it on my album like that.
Right.
But niggas ran around with the tape. Now, okay, because I made a move and I felt I was emotional, I can accept that. You made a move that I didn't feel comfortable with. We both did something to each other that didn't work. Now what we need to do is find a middle ground. The middle ground is for us to do a nice little underground joint together and just scream on niggas and just try to terrorize the mic, have some fun. You get a nice big up, I'll get a nice big up, and we'll both move forward, all right? All right, so all you got to do is just don't get hectic. Get my man, you got my man Don's paging number. You'll know how we moving, and we'll just set it up, And sometime in the next, like, now listen to me, sometime in the next 2 months, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
2 to 3 months, we'll make the joint. Do not fall victim to the pressure in the midst. In the meantime, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know I'm doing the show, you know what I'm doing, but what I'm saying is we'll make it happen, all right?
So the original version eventually came out and everybody knew. So Cannabis already felt disrespected for not appearing in the video, LL Cool J not changing his verse. Now the track comes out and then Cannabis is just like, fuck it, I'm going to release my diss track and we're going to get this thing going. And mind you, at the time, Cannabis had not released his debut album. He was working on it. So this was a huge leap going against a hip hop MC that's legendary like that, going against him is almost career suicide. But Cannabis did not care because he believed in his lyrical skill. And on March 24th, 1998, he dropped his first single, Second Round KO, which was taking direct shots at LL Cool J throughout the whole song. Mike Tyson even decided to do an intro and some ad-libs in the song. And it was a dope track. It was a playoff of LL Cool J's Mama Said Knock You Out track, except this was the Second Round KO.
Get up in this ring, man, put on these gloves, let me show you how to handle
it. You wanna let the world know the truth, you don't want me to shine. You study my rhyme, then you lay your vocals at the mine. That's a bitch move, something that a homo rapper would do. You walk around showing off your body cause it sells, plus to avoid the fact that you ain't got skills. Mad at me cause I kick that shit real, niggas spill. Why 99% of your fans wear high heels? And if you really wanna show off, we could get it on live in front of the cameras on your own sitcom. I let you kick a verse, fuck it, I let you kick them all. I'd even wait for the studio audience to applaud. Now watch me rip the tap from your arm, kick you in the groin, stick you for your Vanguard award in front of your mom. Your first, second, and third born, make your wife get on the horn, call Minister Farrakhan so he can persuade me to squash it. I say nah, he started it, he forgot what a hardcore artist is.
After Second Round KO came out, the ball was officially on LL Cool J's side, and now everyone was waiting to see if LL Cool J would respond. And a month later, on April 28th, 1998, LL Cool J responded with The Ripper Strikes Back. And on this track, he's going not only at Cannabis, but at Mike Tyson and Wyclef Jean for helping him out.
Don't hate me cause I'm Paige, hate me cause I'm everything you wanna be. Handsome, young, plus legendary, talk about Farrakhan. Nigga, you better call Jesse Jackson for some affirmative action. Don't ever open your mouth and mention my scene. Talk about my book, you bought to read. You know you watch the sitcom, nigga, so stop that. Mad rapper, but never turn mad actor. 49 pounds, just trying to be a mobster. Run around town with the Bob Marley imposters. Ask Cannabis, he ain't understanding this. 99% of his fans don't exist. Heard that convicted rapist on the record too. Fresh out of jail, ass cheeks still black and blue. Tell me about the things ear fighter taught you. How to bust another two.
Yeah, that's for the bull.
No more rhyming, you on a lyric fast diet. Call a paramedic and tell him that he's pathetic. His lyrics ain't energetic, as sweet as a diabetic. Career be over next year, yeah, I said it.
After LL released his diss track, Cannabis decided to promote the hell out of his diss track. I mean, he would go on interviews talking about, you know, his diss track towards LL Cool J. He would perform it at various shows. He would perform it on TV at live programs. And there was some rare footage that came out in 1997 of Big Pun, Cannabis, DMX, and Mos Def chilling together. They're having a conversation. They're talking about rappers with big egos. And then towards the end, they all decide to spit a cipher. And while they spit a cipher, Cannabis at that time, with a lot of people didn't know this because the song didn't come out, but he spit a verse, the verse that's in Second Round KO, going at LL Cool J. And I'm sure the rappers in that video knew it was going at LL Cool J. They were hyping him up. They're like going crazy, making loud ass noises. And I mean, it was crazy, man. The verses were insane.
If you let your ego go out of control, ego stops you from being honest. Like, for instance, I could come in here into this restaurant, and if I'm working off of ego, and I'm with the next man who's Big Will, and who's stacking mad chips, my ego is going to force me to be like, well, damn, he's stacking mad chips, and I don't want to look, I don't want to play myself. I probably really can't afford it. I'm going to go that extra length to prove a point.
Right.
honestly, it'd be better for me to just say it'd probably be a lot easier, but the test is for me to say, yo, Duke, I ain't really got like that, so I'ma just chill.
That's ego
is there regardless.
Ego
get the best of you.
Ego could just be just sitting here right now. That's what they say, yo, you want to come to this meeting today with the street team? Like, nah. But you want to come to the meeting today with cannabis?
Exactly.
You're
about to punish
them. That's ego. You know what I'm saying? That's ego. You know what I'm saying?
Now you want to fuck with me, nigga? You crazy? You dripping with whack juice, and you can't get it off. You better be prepared to finish what you start and give me the respect that I deserve. Well, I'ma take it by force, blast you with the 45 Colt, make you somersault, shock you with a couple hundred thousand volt thunderbolts. Before, you wanted the war, now you want to talk. It's about who strikes the hardest, not who strikes first.
So, of course, Cannabis kept promoting the diss track. He kept releasing, you know, new footage. He even dropped a live performance, and there was a special third verse that he wrote and he performed live that never appeared on the official track.
Yo, 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 I battle you on the net, I battle you in the flesh, I battle you over the phone, you could call me collect, I battle you for the respect, I battle you over a blank check, I battle you with a gun in my neck, cause battling's my favorite hobby, that's probably why you despise me, we can battle in hot 97's lobby, constantly battling, out in the streets, or battle of the beast, we can let Angie referee, inside the jail yard fence, prisoners look tense, armed with shanks, waiting for the battle to commence, ladies and gents, pick up the phone and call in the side with the highest, but then decide the winch, lowest versus the highest. I start a riot, feel your fires. You run around screaming, stop the violence. I rip mics tight and appliers. You say you the greatest of all time, you's a liar. Your time's expired. You no longer have what hip hop requires, so retire.
After the crazy promotion of that diss track, Cannabis is getting ready to release his debut album finally, which is called Can I Bust. He's getting ready to release it on September 1998. But there was also a diss going at Cannabis slightly that was released before his album came out, which is the Rasta Imposter Freestyle. LL Cool J ended up going to a radio station freestyling and sending some shots at Cannabis.
Why diss you? You stepped up in the ring, ice grilling in the video like you the next dog king. And tell your man, I know we got some lyrics in the stash, but I'm the best that ever did it, not getting his motherfucking ass. Mic's too hot to hold, leave it in the sand, so I can describe the picture with both hands. You must not understand who's in command. I got all the flavor, your niggas is mad bland.
Now, when Cannabis' debut album dropped, the whole album was literally filled with subliminal shots going at LL Cool J. Now, not every track was, hey, LL, fuck you, this, that. It was just subliminal shots, you know, like little lines here and there on each track going at him. The two tracks that he really went at him subliminally were Buckingham Palace and Get Retarded. Both those tracks on that album were sending subliminal shots at LL Cool J.
When I bomb shit, I get retarded, grinding more than your bargain. I'm talking about rip a mic off your arm shit, hype shit, blow up a mic shit, you might get beat the fuck up in broad daylight with a nightstick.
Most of the battle after the album came out had simmered down. The battle wasn't no longer diss tracks back and forth. In 1999, nothing came out at all that whole year. And then in 2000, when Cannabis and LL Cool J were gearing up for their new albums, there was some subliminal shots sent again at each other. While LL Cool J was promoting his new album, The GOAT, in the year 2000, he decided to stop by BET's Rap City and spit a freestyle, and it's clear in that freestyle he's sending more shots at Cannabis.
Ain't a rapper dead or alive with me. Ask the last cat that tried to come and get me. Talk about paper, talk about broads, talk about movies, I could talk about awards. The fantasies, yo, I got all four. In 2001, I'll be mine by law.
Meanwhile, Cannabis is gearing up to drop his second album, 2000 BC, and in that album, he has about four tracks that are subliminal shots towards LL Cool J. Tracks like Lost at Sea, the title track 2000 BC, 100 Bars, and Mikenificent. Those four tracks all have subliminal shots going at LL Cool J.
9 out of 10 niggas is fraud. You know who you are. Always talk about your bitches and your cars, your jewelry and your girls. It's like we from two different worlds.
Cannabis had dropped his second album on July 18th, 2000. And then 2 months later, LL Cool J dropped his eighth studio album, The GOAT, on September 12th, 2000. And on that album, he even has a few tracks going at Cannabis. Tracks like Shut 'Em Down, the self-titled track LL Cool J, and Back Where I Belong were all slight subliminal shots at Cannabis.
And as far as cannabis go, my man's hitting his ex broad. I'm getting head from his new piece while 20 gangbangers applaud. You came up with that bullshit, some head sucked it up. Then you dropped that garbage album and totally fucked it up. But being the man I am, I tried to show you mercy. I could've told the world the way your label hates your guts, and how me and Wyclef got together to set you up, and how he gave me half your budget. Don't believe me? Look it up. Your A&R promotion niggas, they helped me hook it up. I hate to be responsible for destroying your career. A one-hit wonder, huh? No wonder you disappeared. Mike's still on my arm, nigga. Word up. Both arms, I'm getting another one, nigga.
And of course, Cannabis heard the subliminal shots towards him. So finally, he decides to respond to LL Cool J's The Ripper Strikes Back track that dropped in 1988, and he responded in 2001 with Rip the Jacker. The track is a cover version of LL Cool J's 1998 hit single I'm Bad, and he went as far as to mock the intro as well as the first two bars.
Well, I told you, wish you could take it all back, don't you? Tried to smoke some cannabis, but cannabis smoked you. Calling yourself the greatest is something you don't do. Cause after I humiliate you, what will the goat do? You can't rap or act, my main man. You gon' end up as an intern working for Def Jam. There's a rumor going around that I got dropped. 200,000 albums sold at $10 a pop. 300,000 albums were shipped. You do the math. That's 3 million in 3 months, so kiss my ass.
After that diss track came out, however, LL Cool J did not respond. To him, the battle had died out already and he had no interest in going at Cannabis again. Regardless of LL Cool J not responding to that diss track, Cannabis still dropped three albums that mentioned slightly on certain tracks LL Cool J. On the album See True Hollywood Stories, My Club, The Curriculum, and Rip the Jacker. But on the 2003 album Rip the Jacker, Cannabis, that was the final time Cannabis really mentioned LL Cool J. He mentioned the frustration of how he got blackballed in the music industry and how he kind of regrets doing what he did with that diss track. He felt like he was in a dark moment and that everyone was against him. He even mentioned how much he loves hip-hop and that he'll battle anyone and that he puts a lot of time into his music and his bars, and he's just upset that overall people sided with LL Cool J because he has more Billboard hits and they weren't focusing on the lyrics.
Let the world know the truth, but it became my demise. Motherfucker, you know we even, I don't owe you a dime. Sometimes I feel like killing myself, they stole my shine. I wanted to be the illest for a moment in time. From the ink to my pen to my pad to the ink in my arm. How can one diss song possibly last this long? Tyson ain't the champ no more, the days is gone. And Rip the Jack ain't too stubborn to say when he's wrong.
After 2003, none of the artists ended up mentioning each other anymore. No subliminal shots. LL Cool J was venturing off to doing TV shows and movies, being an executive producer, and Cannabis decided to drop more underground independent albums. Fast forward to December 19th, 2014, and LL Cool J does something special. He decided to perform at Hot 97's Xmas show, and while there, he brought out Cannabis as a surprise guest, officially squashing the beef. They even performed the 4-3-2-1 track, which ironically is the track that started this whole battle in the first place.
What up, man?
Do not post it before the show.
I'm not. Okay. I'm a hold. Yeah. Come on, man. Look at me. Man, it's me.
But yo, I had a lot of beefs in my life, but you know what? Sometimes we gotta be bigger than that. Sometimes you gotta take it to the next level. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes you gotta flip the script. Let's ride.
That's where this battle ends off. Thankfully, it ended off on a good note. They squashed the beef, they performed together, and this is all just hip-hop history now that ended up birthing really dope diss tracks. So with that being said, let's get into who won the battle portion of the beef, which is the short-term portion of the beef. In the midst of the battle, who won this? Now, this is interesting because a lot of people side different ways. A lot of people side with LL Cool J. A lot of people side with Cannabis. So it's going to be interesting to read the comments on who people think really won. My answer for the battle portion of the beef is Cannabis, and here's why. The first reason is the way the beef started. It's really corny the way it started. I mean, LL Cool J was complaining about a line about him wanting to borrow a mic from his arm. Cannabis never meant it in a disrespectful way. A lot of people see it as LL Cool J got his ego hurt over something really small. Cannabis really looked up to LL Cool J. He never meant it in a disrespectful way. I mean, Redman said that. A bunch of people that were there, DMX even said that. And it just seemed like LL Cool J was this legendary MC hip-hop icon that just wanted to start something with someone new. That's what it seemed like. Because Cannabis, I never felt like Cannabis meant it as a disrespectful way. The second reason why I said Cannabis won this was that LL played Cannabis. I mean, he told him to change the verse, and Cannabis was fine with changing the verse, but then he also asked LL Cool J to change his verse, and he never did. He left his verse dissing Cannabis on the track.
And I went down and laid my verse, and you know, everything was cool. I left the studio, everything was copacetic. I got a phone call a couple days later saying from L that he felt I was trying to play him, you know, I should come in and change my verse. You know what I'm saying? So I did. I went and I changed my verse, and he told me he was gonna change his verse, and he left his verse, and it was dissing me, and I didn't even hear it till later on. And when I heard it, I was distraught about it, you know, and I let it go on for a while. I tried to reconcile with him, try and work it out. He didn't put me in the video. He like tried to stomp me out, just like I was saying.
Which is corny. That's like Big Sean not allowing Kendrick Lamar to do his control verse. And then let's just say he allowed him to do it, and then he ended up switching his verse, going at Kendrick on the same track. That would have been whack completely. Big Sean would have looked like the worst artist ever at that time. LL Cool J looked like a shady person doing that, and I would have respected LL Cool J more had he left Cannabis's original verse on that track and kept his verse dissing Cannabis on that track. That would have been more fair, more even. Then people would have been able to be like, okay, maybe this is a legit battle. But that was a whack move, especially for someone who's an icon like that. And the third reason is simply because I liked Cannabis's diss tracks more than I liked LL Cool J's. The fact that Cannabis got Mike Tyson to hop on one of the diss tracks going at LL before he even released his debut album, that's a very good look. I mean, there was a lot of hype surrounding Cannabis at the time. A lot of people were hyped to get his debut album, so this beef just sparked it even more. And LL's diss tracks weren't bad. They were very good. It showed that he was hungry again, and he wanted to prove himself to the hip-hop audience again. But overall, because of those three reasons, I give the battle portion to Cannabis. Now it's time for the war portion of the beef. This is after the beef had settled down, whose career still went on and prevailed. And this is a very, very clear answer. I give this to LL Cool J. I mean, the man's still dropping albums on TV shows, NCIS, doing movies, all kinds of stuff, hosting the Grammys. He's clearly been out in the mainstream more and excelling, doing all kinds of stuff. And Cannabis is still releasing music, but it's clear that it's not really hitting. You know, most people don't even know that Cannabis is still releasing music. So this is an easy win for LL Cool J. So with that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed this episode of Who Really Won. Leave a comment below. Let me know what you guys think on who really won in this battle. Was it Cannabis? Was it LL Cool J? Leave your reasons below. Also, leave a comment below on what battle you guys want me to do next. I always read them, so this gives me more ideas to do different battles. And I've covered a lot of different battles. If you go to my channel, click on playlist, click on Who Really Won episodes, you'll see I've done coverage on 50 Cent versus Rick Ross, Gucci versus Jeezy, T.I. versus Lil Flip, and much, much more. You can even click the video link at the end of this video. It'll take you straight to the playlist, so go ahead and check that out. With that being said, like, share, and definitely subscribe. I do videos like this daily on hip-hop news, who changed the music industry, and much, much more. Follow me on Twitter and on Instagram at QuakeGW. Like us on Facebook, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Peace.